welcome to the VHA. Thank you so much for choosing us. Our agenda here at the VHA is to empower you to lead an incredible life through hairdressing. I myself have had an amazing life through hairdressing. I don't know about amazing actually, but I've had a pretty decent life through hairdressing, and I want to show you guys how to do that. And I feel like we're better equipped to do that than any other school because we're a salon company and I'm a hairdresser. I'm a hairdresser who trained a lot of people over the years, a lot of very successful hairdressers over the years. And one day I decided, hey, you know what? My program is good enough that I think it should be its own school. And I think I should get paid for it too, because I was doing it for free. And it was a challenging thing for me for many years, but we built our company from two people, my wife and I, to 50 people and three locations just by teaching people who had good service aptitude and the right attitude how to become a successful hairdresser. And now we're gonna show you guys how to do that. So in our program, it's a 6-month program broken up into 2 3-month parts. In the first 3 months, you're a junior stylist, so we're gonna teach you everything there is to know. You will learn everything in that first 3 months that you will ever need to know in your entire career, which sounds totally crazy. The problem is you won't have mastered it, but we're gonna give you all of the information you need to know in that 3 months. And 3 months with us is 36 days. We're gonna teach you more than any other school is gonna teach you, so you're gonna be kind of overwhelmed, but don't worry. Here's how it kind of goes. Day one, we're gonna introduce you to your kit, which I'm gonna show you in just a minute. We're gonna do a little orientation, show you where the bathroom is, talk about some of the rules and guidelines, be nice to each other, show up. You know, we're a very short program, you gotta be there. But we'll talk to you, your instructors will tell you a little more details with that. Here's what I want you to know. We're gonna put scissors in your hand on day one. We're gonna put scissors in your hand a few hours into your very first day. And what's cool is the very first haircut we're gonna teach you is the haircut that it took me about 4 years, maybe 5 years in the industry to learn. And when I learned this haircut, it completely changed my life. I was faking it for almost 5 years when it came to any longer hair. I did not know how to do it, and I faked it and I pretended. And then one day somebody, my mentor, a woman named Gina Derry, showed me this haircut. She goes, let me show you a better way to lay your hair. And she showed me this haircut. And this haircut turned on all the light bulbs and put me on a pathway to understanding longer hair. And that's why I want you to learn this as your very first haircut, because for 4 years, I sweat and panicked and faked it and thinned hair out and used razors because I didn't know how to cut with longer hair. And once I learned this haircut, I gotta be honest, for about 5 years, I did it on every single person who had longer hair. Every single person, and it did very, very well for me. So it's gonna be the very first thing that we teach you at the Vancouver Hair Academy. That's why, for me, it's a profound experience. For you guys are kind of just like, oh my God, I don't know even what he's talking about. But I want you guys to understand that our program is a very personal thing for me. This is my system of cutting hair. I've learned it from many, many years of working with some of the best hairdressers in the world. And then I fine-tuned it and made it easier so that anybody could understand it, because I've realized that in a lot of hairdressing, there's a lot of wasteful, superfluous sectioning and silliness where people don't even know why they're doing what they're doing. And I believe you should always know why you do what you do. So that's what I want to teach you guys. And this first haircut you're going to learn today, I want you to call up a friend after this first day of hairdressing school and say, come on over, bring over a bottle of wine. We're going to cut your hair in the kitchen tonight. That's what I want you to do. I want you to be excited and empower you to have an amazing career through hairdressing starting right from day one. I hated hairdressing school. My first day of hairdressing school, I wanted to cry and go home and never come back, but I stuck it out. But when I started my hairdressing school, my agenda with my school was to help you to not have that experience. I want you to leave day one going, this is amazing. I can't wait to come back on day two. Now, here's a couple of things, guys. If in your group, sometimes we have small groups, sometimes we have larger groups, up to 6 people, sometimes as many as 2 people. But here's the thing, don't worry about it if you don't get this. You wouldn't be in hairdressing school if you knew how to cut hair. It's not easy. When you watch my videos, when you watch your hairdresser, when you watch any hairdresser moving hair around, it looks really, really easy. Well, guess what, guys? It's not. It takes time. It takes time to learn that that muscle memory. You have never held anything in your fingers like this with tension in your entire life because you have thumbs. Why would you hold things like this? You would hold things like this. So we're gonna be using muscles in your hands you have never used before. And some people are gonna get it quick, some people aren't. Holding hair up is a very frustrating endeavor. What ends up happening is the hair sags, the hair slips out of your fingers, all sorts of things happen until you get a stronger finger, okay? So we're gonna, don't worry about it if you don't get it right away. Don't worry about it if your neighbor seems to be getting it and you're kind of freaking out going, oh my God, I don't get this. Here's what I will tell you guys. When you have to work harder to master something, you will cherish it and value it more. I have known some incredibly gifted, talented hairdressers who quit the industry because they didn't find it challenging or exciting because they never had to dig deep to become good. They just were good and they're like, well, that wasn't really that interesting for me. I had to work extremely hard to become good at this, and I am good at it, but I worked really, really hard at it. And what I've learned, I want to teach you guys, and I want to teach you there's so much more to this industry than just what your hands do. There's such a personal connection. You're going to learn all of this stuff through your program at the VHA. So, like I said, if you're stressing out, if you're freaking out, you're kind of going, I don't get this, I don't know what's going on, the people around me seem to be understanding this or doing better than I'm doing, don't worry about it. You'll be fine. Everybody gets this. In my entire career of 20 years of training people to do hair, 1996 I started teaching people. 21 years of doing education in this industry, I've only met two people I couldn't teach to do hair. I have trained hundreds and hundreds of hairdressers to have a better life through hairdressing, and I'm gonna show you the same thing. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about your kit. It's Christmas time at the VHA, and we're gonna go through your kit and see what kind of wonderful stuff you have. I've picked everything that's in your kit. Very specifically, it's stuff that I personally have chosen. There's some things that, you know, if a distributor didn't have the clips that I originally wanted, then we're working with a different clip. But almost everything in this kit is exactly what I have chosen for you, and I'm very specific on what I want you to have. And I believe this, a lot of hairdressing schools will give you garbage equipment because they think you're gonna treat it poorly. And I'm the exact opposite. I want you to have good equipment that you do not have to rebuy. I want you to have awesome equipment that you can then set foot into any salon and not be embarrassed about. When I went to hairdressing school, I had to throw away all my stuff. Phone's ringing. I had to burn all my equipment, throw it out of a moving car, because it was so bad and it was so embarrassing to be seen in a cool downtown salon with this garbage equipment. And I don't want you guys to have that. I want you to have the best stuff that we can give you. And then we're gonna teach you how to use it properly. So that's really what we believe in, good habits right from day one. So let's go through this. It's gonna be Christmas time, as I said. Here's your suitcase, Vancouver Hairdressing Academy, VHA. So I'm gonna go through what's in this suitcase for you today. And I'm gonna hold everything up. So let's see, how do we open this thing? This is exciting and fun for me too, guys. Okay, I'm gonna take a few things out. There's a few things that don't matter. Here's an apron, a color apron, wear this. But here's the hairdresser's secret, all black. Guess what, my shirt says, better than your hairdresser, because I am better than your hairdresser. We're gonna give you an apron so you can wear this so you don't put bleach or color stains all over your clothing. Don't wear sweaters and things to work. Sweaters that are natural fibers that are kind of like sweatery. When you cut hair, that hair is gonna stick inside your sweater and it's never gonna come out, and then your sweater's ruined. So wear half synthetic fibers, wear polyester blends, wear simple things that you can take a Sharpie and color in on your blacks. Hairdresser uniform is black and blacker. That's what I believe. So anyways, here's an apron. We're gonna start, guys, with, I didn't prep any of this stuff. So we're gonna start with your combs. I believe this is gonna be a bag of combs. First, this, I'm holding it at me, but you need to see it. This is a YS Park comb. This is a fabulous cutting comb. I'm gonna open it up a little bit for you, just so you can see why this comb is kind of unique and special. And somebody is gonna get this kit. Maybe it's you. Maybe you will get the kit that Michael used as a demonstration kit. So this is a cutting comb, a YS Park comb. You can usually tell, or always tell, a YS Park comb because the holes in it. If you watch a lot of advanced hairdressing videos, a lot of hairdressers use this comb. I like this comb. It's a good size, it's a good weight. We've got a nice fine teeth, and then we've got our wider teeth, and then we've got a little sectioning part here. You'll see that it's missing a tooth, and that's for us to carve out sections. Standard cutting comb, good quality, lightweight. And YS Park, there's a cool history with YS Park. He actually worked in Vancouver for a little while. Now he's in Japan, making some of the most highly sought after tools in our industry, but he actually was a hairdresser who worked in Vancouver. Pretty neat. So YS Park cutting comb. I like YS Park equipment. I don't necessarily think it's the best, but I like the way it feels in your hand. And for me, it's all about that. We have another cutting comb. This is called a Buoy Pro comb. This is a classic comb. I always think that when they translated this from Japanese into English, they forgot the T. If you can see this, guys, it says Buoy, but it's kind of like beauty without the T. And I think they just spelled it wrong and then they just didn't want to admit that they made a mistake and they stuck with it. But Buoy Pro combs are awesome. And when you see somebody working with a Buoy Pro comb, they know what they're doing. Hairdressers with a Buoy Pro comb tend to be legit old school hairdressers. I don't know if I can open this thing. You know what, I'm not gonna open it. We're just gonna talk about it. Buoy Pro combs, you can only get these in one place in Vancouver. These are only available at West Coast Beauty. And what I wanted to do is give you another option for a standard cutting comb. This one has wider teeth, but the fine teeth are about the same. It's a little heavier, and it's just a beautiful, simple hair cutting comb, classic. I believe in putting these classic things in your hands. Let's see, what else? Now this is another Buoy Pro comb. And this is my favorite. This is, guard this comb with your life, guys. So this comb is a multi-purpose comb. Buoy Pro is the only company that makes a comb like this. There's lots of other companies that have things that are similar. They'll be rounded, they'll be just slightly different shape. This is a more sophisticated shape. And I like this comb for a couple of different things. One, I like this for scissor over combing on men's hair or short hair. So I use this when I, because it's a little wider here, for doing my longer parts of a scissor over comb as I'm doing my barbering. I also like this for combing colors through hair or deep conditioning products. It's just a beautiful comb that feels great in the hand. People will steal, people are gonna steal everything, but people will steal this, man. Guard this comb with your life. It's a fabulous comb and it's one of my favorites. I cannot live without this comb. I'm gonna put that back so I don't lose this. Try to do everything in order. Sealed up, nice. We'll do one more cutting comb before we get to a more specialty comb. Now this is a specialty comb as well. This is a cutting comb, and again, this one is designed for scissor over combing and for short hair, and I'll show you why if I can get it open with my big cave person fingers. Here we go. So right now you have two standard cutting combs, then you have a really big comb that also doubles as a scissor over combing comb or a comb for distributing color or product through hair. Now we have a specialty comb that can really only be used for one thing, but you need to have one of these. This is another scissor over combing comb. Look how flexible this is. This is another YS Park comb. You can see it from the three holes here. It's tapered this way. And it's basically for getting into the fine little detail parts of men's hair. You can push it in. Look what I can do to this. To push it in, it kind of wraps into the little crevices of men's hair onto their skull. If you need to really get in behind the ears or the nape of the neck, all the little curvy parts, this comb is wonderful for getting in there. But it's terrible to use for actual hair cutting, guys, because when you go to pull a section of hair with tension, the comb flexes. So it's really only got one purpose, but you will use this a lot. And when you start to do a lot of men's work, and if you want to do a lot of hand-tailored men's work with scissors, not just clippers, you will love this comb. It's a brilliant comb. Don't lose it. You will regret losing it. But at the same time, you may not get a huge amount of use out of it, but when you do, you will love this comb. Then we get into our tail comb, guys. So a tail comb is basically for foiling and for balayage and that kind of stuff. It's a wonderful comb for separating hair and sections of hair. So I'm very particular on the tail comb that you guys use. I'm gonna come in right close to the camera. Now, what you will see, I hope this you can see this, is this is a kind of a seamless curve. There's a little bump right here, but a seamless curve from the tail comb part of it, the metal tail comb, and I don't like using plastic tail combs, I like metal, they last longer. And basically what I like about this is when we are foiling, when we're weaving a foil, when we go to scoop up our section, we can grab the hair and pinch it off. Sometimes your tail combs will have this corner on them and this will not be rounded. It'll kind of come down and then square off. And I always find when I go to grab my section, it doesn't come off as easily and it drives me crazy. So I want you guys to not be driven crazy. This will make your foiling life easier. So when you're looking for a tail comb, when you lose this or somebody steals it from you, because they will, because everybody likes a good tail comb. When you lose this or someone steals it from you, when you go to buy another one, it doesn't have to be a YS Park, but make sure that this is rounded and it's not a square here, okay? Anyways, that's what it's for. You gotta keep your tail comb. Everybody will steal. Here's the thing, guys. You're gonna mark all of your stuff with nail polish, because not because your coworkers at the salon or at school are gonna steal your stuff, but maybe what ends up happening is y'all have the same stuff. So you need to be able to know whose was whose, because when you have the chaos of all of your gear being out and you're doing haircuts and then somebody drops something and then picks up one of yours by accident because they misplaced theirs, it's not deliberate, but it happens. So it's really good to have your stuff marked. So what I recommend you do is get a very particular color of nail polish and just put a dot or two or some kind of thing that tells you exactly where your, or so you know exactly where your stuff is at all times. So there's no dispute, because there's nothing worse than you don't mark your stuff. You feel pretty confident that the girl sitting next to you or the guy sitting next to you has your comb and you can't prove it. And they're gonna say, well, I don't have, this is mine. And if they have all the same stuff, you can't really prove it, and now you got bitterness. Guard your stuff with your life. Tail comb. We're gonna go into the razor because it was in that same bag, okay guys? This is gonna be a long video. Razor. Now, here's what you're gonna do with this razor. What this is a cheap imitation copy of a very expensive razor. This is the only cheap thing that you're gonna get, and I'll tell you why. I could give you the $150 razor. Well, you could pay for the $150 razor, but you may not really get into razor cutting. Only certain people really, really like razor cutting. So what I did was I figured out a way, like normally it's like a stick of plastic, your razor, and you just kind of hold it like this and you carve out hair. Well, a feather plié is a more sophisticated tool, and what I wanted to do was introduce you to working with a feather plié or that style of razor, a fold-out razor, but not have the financial commitment, because you may never pick up a razor again. You may say, I hate razor cutting. But if you say, I love razor cutting, then on your own, you can go buy that $150 feather plié. It's a waste of your money unless you love razor cutting. So here's what we do. You will notice that there is a thing in here, this inserty thing. This is for a very blade specific type of blade for this razor. Well, guess what? We don't need it. So you can take this thing out and throw it as far as you want, or just chuck it in your suitcase because you don't need it. Now, what I have done is I'm fitting very, very expensive, good quality Casio Teflon coated, never cut yourself blades, and I've figured out a razor that meets my criteria of what I'm looking for you guys. And these, which can't cut you because there's guards on them, right? They can't, I mean, if you really push, they can cut you, but they're pretty safe. And now I've figured out a way to fit these into these. So I'm gonna show you, and I hope this works. The way you do this, you will see, can you see this slot here? What we need to do is angle the blade. I'm going to just step back just in case the focus isn't working well. You see what I did there? I kind of push it in on an angle. Now that's sitting right in line with the slot. And then all I simply have to do is just push it in. And look at that. It's like almost a perfect fit. Pretty cool. I figured this out for you. So here's what we do. Here's how we use our razor. So I want y'all to go through this with me, guys. First, you know, get your blades in. Take your stuff. By the way, your blades, these are about $1.50 a blade. So don't lend them out. Don't ask people to borrow things, and don't, like, always come to work ready to work with your own gear. And when you do that, if somebody asks you, say no, it's okay. Don't ask people to borrow things and don't lend things to people, okay? It just makes your relationships much cleaner. So here's the thing, here's your closed razor. We open it past halfway, okay? Let's do that again. It's closed, we open it all the way past halfway. Now, if you're right-handed, you're gonna put your right palm out like this, and this is aiming towards your thumb, and we just open, cram it in there, and close. And now we can razor cut. Cool? This is how it works. I'm gonna do it one more time. The reason is half of you guys are gonna do this wrong. I usually make people do this about 10 times, so do this about 10 times. Closed razor. Open it up. Notice I went past halfway, all the way to here. I don't know how many degrees this is, but let's just say here is 6 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock, and it's facing this way. It's facing towards your thumb if your hand is out like this. So open your fingers, cram it in there. See that the curvy part rests against my finger here. Cram it in there, squeeze, and razor cut. Now we're gonna get to the more subtle nuances of how to use a razor later on when you learn how to use razors, but that's how you do it. Last time, ready? Open, so facing this way, cram it in there. What you're saying, why is he saying this so many times? Because half of you are doing it wrong right now. And then cut, 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 razor cutting, awesome. I hope you guys embrace it and you love it. We do a lot of our razor training. Most of our team really specializes in razor cutting. We go to Arojo in New York. You can watch Nick Arojo. He's a very famous hairdresser. He was the guy on What Not to Wear, the British guy. He did a lot of his work with a razor. He uses a red feather plie. He's an old friend of mine, and he taught me how to razor cut, which is really, really cool. So we may have a couple of his videos on your iPads. So that, my friends, is it for your combs. I am gonna put them away into this bag now so that I don't lose things. Now, I'm not gonna be going through some of your tools with you because we may be doing different blow dryers, we may be doing different curling irons by the time you get your kit. So I'm gonna leave this out. Clips. You will probably be issued 6 clips. They're just hair sectioning clips. I prefer these. You're gonna see at the beauty supplies that they have these big knuckly kind of crazy clips. I just like a basic simple clip for clean work. The bigger the clip, harder it is to do clean work. So I like a simple clip. This has 4 in it. We usually issue 2 more because you're supposed to get 6. So make sure you get 6 clips and you mark them. You can do them under the tab, like here. If you take a bit of nail polish and you put it underneath here, that'll keep it safe. So mark your clips, man. Clips are one of those things. Every time I come to work, I come home with 2 less clips than I arrived with. So these are Framar clips, but you may not be using these. These are a Canadian company, which is kind of cool. Let's get to your brushes, friends. You're gonna have 3 round brushes. 3 round brushes. I'm gonna hold up, so there's 2 natural bristle round brushes, right? We got a smaller one and a larger one. Natural bristle brushes create smoothness and gentle soft wave. They don't generally create volume because smooth hair is rarely big. When we're smoothing hair, we're closing the cuticle. When we are making hair big, like back combing and things like that, or volume, that hair tends to have a bit of frizz to it, meaning it's not smooth. So it's hard to get volume with smooth hair. A natural bristle round brush, if you think about, you've all seen pictures of deep conditioning treatments for hair where they show damaged hair and it's all like this in a microscope, and then the smooth hair, the cuticles down. Well, these have cuticles too because they're natural. I think it's, I don't know, it's a boar hair or something like that. Anyways, so it's a bit gnarly, and those kind of gnarly microscopic bits, they catch your microscopic bits and they smooth them down. And that's what's so cool about natural bristles. So we've given you a big one and a little one. They have a ceramic core, but guess what? That's a huge lie. The ceramic thing is a lie when it comes to brushes. Don't get sucked into that. It's nonsense. The hair never touches the ceramic. The hair never even makes it this far to touch the ceramic, and the ceramic doesn't get hot enough to actually do anything. Ceramic itself does do things when you heat it up, but this is not doing anything, and it's a big old lie, so don't worry about that. I like to smash myths, because I'll tell you guys what, companies like to think hairdressers are stupid, and they want you guys to think that whatever they tell you, you're gonna believe. They want you to be loyal to their brand. Most of what hair companies tell you is nonsense, and we're here. I want you guys to not be loyal to anybody but yourself and the company that you work for. I don't want you to think that your skill set depends on a certain brand or a manufacturer. I want you to be empowered to realize that the power lies in your brains and in your hands, and that's what we want to teach you here. So here's another brush. This is a synthetic bristle brush. So the bristles are synthetic, and you'll notice the core of this brush has holes in it. So that does a couple of things. One, The bristles are actually up in the center on a wound wire and the bristles stick out, so there has to be holes in the brush for the bristles to come through. But the other thing that's kind of cool is that allows air to pass through the brush onto the other side and it dries hair quite fast. So it allows for a volume. Because that air passes through, we're not getting quite as much smoothness to the hair. And these bristles don't really grip the hair quite as well as natural bristle. It allows us to get a little more volume into the hair. And I find I can get nice big round brush, sexy kind of wave, but volume with one of these. So you've got a good standard sized synthetic bristle round brush. This is the paddle brush here. To be honest, we went with an inexpensive paddle brush for you guys because it works super well. It's a fabulous product and you didn't need to spend a bunch of money on a paddle brush. Here's a couple key things about a paddle brush. They're cushioned, so you can kind of really beat your client with them and they don't hurt. And they're designed for detangling longer hair. They can detangle any kind of hair, but you can kind of get in there and be a little aggressive because they're a bit of a softer cushioned bristle, and they're great also for doing wrap dries and getting a big length of hair and blow drying with them. Every hairdresser needs a paddle brush. It's a great tool to have, whether you have a square one or like this or a rounded one. A couple key things of the paddle brush. If you're really eagle-eyed, you might notice that it's missing one bristle in here. It's actually not missing a bristle. That's actually a hole to allow the air to escape, or else it would not be soft and cushiony. It's also, when you wash your brush, it allows the water to escape. So that's what that hole is for. Paddle brush is an essential tool for hairdressers. You can spend a lot of money or a little money. They're all kind of the same. So we spent a little money on it because why spend a lot if you don't need to? Then we are going to get into our other detangling brush. This is one of my favorite tools. My wife introduced me to this years ago, about 18 years ago when we opened our first salon. She told me about the legendary Isinus brush. Well, I know it's legendary now. Back then, I just thought this is a pretty basic, boring looking brush. This is a miracle for detangling hair. You can take this brush and put it in the most nasty tangled hair and aggressively, without really caution, just kind of mow through it, and it doesn't really hurt the client. Like, don't go aggressive crazy with it, but you'd be really surprised how well this detangles the most tangly, awful hair, and you can really kind of go through it. It's really awesome. But the big thing with this brush, guys, the kicker with this brush, do not ever blow dry with this brush. It'll melt the bristles. That doesn't mean they will turn to liquid and melt. I'm melting. But what they will do is curl and turn, and you'll ruin this brush. It is designed for one thing and one thing only, and that is, right, detangling. Your Denman brush. Your Denman brush is what I call a desert island brush. I cannot live without a Denman brush. I love this brush. What makes it so special is, first of all, the curve of this brush is perfect for creating those short hairstyles, those geometrics, your bobs, your fireflies. They make the hair straight and just with enough bevel so it sits in a flattering way. It's a beautiful finish with these brushes. The padding here, you can't really see it. Let me just show you. This red padding, this rubber, is really sticky, like it's quite grippy. And when the hair hits that, it really stretches it out, makes hair very smooth, very easy to control, and very shiny. The bristles themselves are really hard. I don't know necessarily that the bristles are that special. It's really about the base of this brush. What the bristles do, we call this the old scalp scraper. What the bristles allow us to do is kind of get in and get behind a client and roll it forward. And if you watch some of my videos, you'll see me doing this. It's a move I make around the hairline, and it really, I can get a lot of tension on the hair and really stretch out that hairline hair. And that hair around the hairline is often very tricky. And that can be the difference between a decent blow dry and an incredible blow dry. So I always use a Denman brush. I would say every single one of my clients gets a Denman brush on the first couple of inches up front of the hairline. I call it the front of the headphone section, a halo section. I Denman brush everybody. It just gives a wonderful finish. I cannot live without this brush. Now, don't treat it like a round brush and go through and turn it like this. We can do little things like I'll rotate it this way to make hair swing the way I want, but don't turn it, because if you want to get the effect of a round brush, use a round brush. But I will finesse hair in different directions by I'll pull it down and then drop my wrist in, and that can make that hair swing forward or backwards depending on what it is I'm doing. You can control the hair really beautifully with a Denman brush as well, but I don't like to use it as a round brush. Let this natural, the curl that we have here, the turn that we have on top, that is enough for most hairstyles. Now, also, we don't include this in our kit. I got one in my kit when I was in hairdressing school. No one told me about all the stuff in my kit, but I had a Denman brush that was actually a round brush. Those are a disaster waiting to happen. Never ever be tempted to buy a Denman style brush that is a full circle round brush. I promise you, you will get it tangled in your client's hair or in your own hair, and you will have to cut it out. You cannot get these things out once they're tangled. A Denman brush, I've never tangled in someone's hair, but a Denman round brush is a nightmare. It's a disaster waiting to happen, so avoid it like the plague. Hey guys, okay, so we're gonna talk a little bit about your scissors, the most exciting part of your entire kit. Let's take your scissors out. I have very specifically chosen this brand of scissors for you for a few different reasons. I'll try to explain these to you. It's a pretty nice little case here, and I believe it's got a little magnetized flap. So we're gonna take your scissors out, and I'm gonna show you how to hold them and how to work with them. So in your scissor case, you're gonna have scissors, oil, and a scissor tightening kind of key. And I'll explain to you why you need these things. Now, scissors, guys, I hate to be the one to break this to you, but they're basically two pieces of metal that rub together with a lot of frequency. So there's friction created, and we've gotta lubricate. Anytime there's two pieces of metal that are touching, we've gotta lubricate them. So let's get out our clipper oil. It's gonna be the first thing we do today. Now this one, I'm gonna put the scissors down so I don't cut myself. You know, most of the time people cut themselves is when they're horsing around, it's not when they're actually doing what they're supposed to be doing. So I've got a little bit of oil, and I'm gonna open my blade, and I'm gonna put a little oil here and a little oil here. This is the fulcrum of the shear, and we just need to put a little bit of oil. You don't need a huge amount. And then we just kind of open and close them a few times. Now, I'm just gonna close up my oil so I don't spill it anywhere and put it back. The second thing we gotta do is determine if our scissors are too light or too tight or too loose. And I feel like these are a little too tight. So where did I put that key? Here we go. Now, we need a special key for this scissor. A lot of scissors will have a big, it's called a tension screw. I very carefully picked these for you because I like you guys to use the type of equipment that I myself like to use. And there are more expensive scissors out there, but you will never in your lives find a better pair of shears for the money than this. A lot of schools will issue a brand of scissors called Casios. In fact, you may be tempted to go buy some Casio shears at the end of this program. These are every bit as good as Casio shears costing up to about $800. These are fabulous scissors, and every time I use them, I'm always really impressed by them. But I'm gonna show you something. A lot of scissor brands will have a big tension screw here that you can just hand tighten. I don't like that because when I'm cutting hair, it gets in the way of my comb. I don't like that screw, so I like it to be quite seamless. So I have asked our manufacturer to provide us with this kind of a flush tension screw. Now, what they've done in a way to be fancy, sometimes there'll just be a screwdriver insert, like just a line for a flat screwdriver. Well, these guys have got all fancy, so they've got some special kind of key, because if you look closely, I don't know if you can see this, there's actually two holes rather than a line. So we use this key there, and we can go lefty loosey, righty tighty. So I think they're too tight, so I'm gonna back off a little bit, and you can hear, can you hear it click? I'm pretty sure you can. So I'm gonna back off a little bit and see if that's still a little too tight. I'll show you what the test is, guys. The test is, that's a bit too loose now. When you drop the shear, it shouldn't close all the way. It should only close to about here. And the reason is this. We need to get the tension, the blades to be connecting at the right amount, so because if it's too tight, that means that the blades are gonna be pushing on each other too much and it's gonna grind down your scissors too quickly. And if it's too loose, the hair can actually kind of go between the blades and get folded between the blades and not cut. Really, really frustrating. So we've got to get our blades exactly, still a little bit, one more, righty tighty. Let's see. That's pretty good. Because really, when we're cutting hair, guys, we're really only using the last inch of the shear, inch to inch and a half. You're rarely cutting back here unless you're doing some slide cutting and stuff like that. When we're cutting, we're usually doing the first inch. So now I'm gonna show you to hold scissors. So we're gonna put this key away. Do not lose this, guys, or else it makes it a lot harder to tighten. You can actually use your fingernails to do it. I've done it lots of times with my fingernails, but hang on to this thing. Keep it, put it back into your scissor container. Now, here's how we hold scissors. A lot of you guys are gonna be like, oh, well, paper scissors are like this. Well, that's not how we hold hairdressing scissors. These are called offset scissors. The reason I go with offset is because it's more ergonomic for your hand. Your hand doesn't cramp up, but basically you'll notice that this is set further back. You'll also notice that this comes up. These are not symmetrical. These are offset shears, and the design of it is, we use this finger and your thumb in a scissor. So we put our hand out like this, and that's how we hold the scissor, okay? Third finger goes into them, and then our thumb goes in. Now, the reason that they're offset, if they were perfectly symmetrical, the thumb would be right on top of that finger. It's easier if it's just moved over slightly. So that's what the offset does, is it allows us to move over slightly, okay? Now, when we're holding shears, we only open and close our thumb. Look at that, isn't that fancy? Doesn't that look cool? I'm actually terrible at this. If you see any movement on my hand, that's because I'm no good at this, because nobody trained me how to do this properly. I learned it way later, and that allowed me to develop some bad habits. So I want you guys to have good habits right away. So, that's what we're gonna practice, just thumbs. And you notice I'm taking big bites. I'm kind of going like alligator style, like open wide, clomp, clomp, clomp. That's what we're doing here, big bites, okay? See, did you see that? These are still too tight. Can you hear that? Little whistle, sounds like my rats. The way that we can learn to isolate just our thumb so we can look like a fancy hairdresser who does things properly, because again, it's really hard to do, took me a long time to learn how to do it, is flattening out our hand so our hand can't move. So what you're gonna do whenever you're watching hairdressing videos of me teaching you how to do hair or any other videos, you're gonna sit with your scissors on your leg, and that leg is gonna isolate, I hope you can see this, isolate, well, here's your leg, okay? You've got your scissors on your lap, and now my arm is my leg, and that allows me to just open and close my thumb, and that's gonna teach you guys how to isolate that muscle, okay? Does that make sense? So you're just gonna sit here and open and close and open and close all through your videos. Just make sure you don't cut anything. Don't cut your pants, don't cut your finger. You know, don't cut your neighbor. You're just gonna sit here and do this until this movement becomes super, super organic for you guys. So you can just move your thumb. And then when you go take a class at Sassoon's, they're gonna say, dang, you guys have really good scissor hands. You're gonna say, I know, I went to the Vancouver Hair Academy. Mike Levine taught me, right? Okay, so now here's another thing we do with our scissors. It's how we control our shears when we're not cutting hair. I'm gonna pretend that this is my comb right now. Now, when we're cutting hair, we don't wanna be stabbing our clients in the head, but we also don't wanna be putting our scissors down. We have to keep our scissors in our hand and our comb in our hand. Everything's kind of in our hands at the same time. I'm gonna show you what the mechanics of that look like. I don't really have a comb. Some window washers banging on my window. I don't really have a comb, so I'm gonna use this insert from the razor as my comb demonstration. So when we're cutting hair, we're holding our comb, we comb it, actually here's what the mechanics of it are, guys. Okay, scissors are in our hand. Comb kind of always stays in your right hand, does it? Cut, 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 nope, the comb goes into the, sometimes you have to think about these things. So here's what we're doing. We have a section of hair and we're cutting it, right? So we're cutting, cutting, cutting. Yes? You see that? Now, when we go to grab our next section, we have to secure our scissors. And there's two ways to secure your scissors. One, we just simply take the thumb out and squeeze. Then we take our comb and put it into our hand, and now we've got our thumb and our fingers. We can comb hair around, right? Comb it any way we want it. And then our comb goes between our thumb and our forefinger while we're holding the section of hair. And then we cut, cut, cut. And then we take our thumb out, squeeze, grab our comb, 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 comb. Pretty simple, right? That's the basic way of doing things. We don't want to be basic, but you can be basic if you want, but I don't want to be basic. When I went to hairdressing school, I learned it this way. But then there was one girl I went to school with that when she would cut my hair, there was this glint of flash of steel, and I was like, what are you doing? Show me what you're doing with your scissors. It looks so fancy. So I'm gonna show you what she was doing. Now I have fat fingers, so I'm gonna take this insert out, because when this insert is out, this hole is a little bit bigger. So what she was doing and what she taught me 25 years ago is you take your thumb out, take your pinky out, you push back and drop it back into his hand. So here's the movement, it's like this, okay? And it looks kind of fancy, right? It's kind of like, whoa, he's really flipping his scissors around. But here's how you do it, here's the mechanics of it. The thumb, squeeze. And
thumb comes out, push with our forefinger, open our fingers, let it drop in, and squeeze.
And then we cut, comb, all this kind of stuff, because here's my comb, remember? Comb. Then we put our comb back in, and we turn our hand over, and we just flip it forward, okay? I got a little turn on me. If my fingers are dead straight and I'm doing this, my scissors might fly off. So I've got a little bit of a kind of a grip, right? Because that's gonna keep my scissors from flying off my hands. So it's kind of, there's a little kind of little grippy thing that you do here just to make sure your scissors don't fly off your hands. And then we cut, and that's what we do it. And that is the flip. I want you all to learn the flip because the flip is fancy. So here's how we're gonna learn the flip. Tonight, when you go home to watch The Bachelor or whatever it is you watch, I know your generation doesn't watch TV, but whatever you guys are doing, if you happen to be watching some TV or some kind of streaming something, you're gonna take your scissors. And you are going to wrap the tip with a rubber band. You're gonna get a rubber band on there real tight so that they don't open up, and you're just gonna sit there doing this for like half an hour until this becomes really natural for you, okay? You're just gonna do this over and over and over and again, okay? I don't even have to think about it, it just happens. And that's what you're gonna do until you develop scissor mastery. The more comfortable you get with your shears in your hand, the better a hairdresser you're going to be. Now, if you wanna get super, super fancy, I want you to understand this. I don't really do this, but it does look pretty cool. You can then kind of do like the full-on gunslinger flip, but there's a risk of your scissors opening up this way. And if your scissors open up, that's a really dangerous thing for you and for your client. But I'm pretty good at this because I do this every once in a while, but even when I'm on stage and stuff like that, I don't do this. But I should, because it looks pretty cool. But anyways, flip, right? Looks cool, clients go, damn, that person's really, really good. That's what we do. That's how you look fancy with the scissor, and that's how you protect your shear. So you have two choices. Thumb out, fist, comb. Thumb out, flip, grip, comb. Do whatever one you feel better about, whatever one makes sense for you, okay? So one final thing about scissors, guys. Guard your scissors with your life. If you drop your shears, they're never gonna be the same. It's like a car getting into an accident. It's the same thing with a lot of your equipment. If you drop your shears, they're never the same, so make sure that they don't get dropped, okay, guys? Put them back in your case if you're not using them. Wear them in your scissor holster, which we are providing you with a scissor holster for all of your combs and that kind of stuff as well. Just make sure that your stuff stays safe. The longer you keep your scissors from hitting the ground, they are gonna hit the ground, it's going to happen. I drop my scissors sometimes, it sucks, but it is gonna happen. But the less that happens, the less likely you are gonna need new shears. You know, I'll tell you guys, the need for new equipment is greatly reduced if you take care of the things that you have. It's as simple as that. And I keep dropping stuff. Okay guys, clippers and edgers. We'll talk about your clippers first. We've picked, at this point we're using wall sterlings. If something better comes along or that makes more sense for us, we'll switch to that. We're always looking to improve our equipment rather than degrade it. So anytime we change something, it's with an effort to make it better. Here's why we've chosen the wall sterling. First of all, wall is a really, really highly respected, been around forever clipper brand. The oldest brands tend to be Wall, Oster, and I can't think of the name, but there's one other brand that's been around forever. Those are the brands that you wanna get. You wanna have a company that's been around for a long time, but Wall tends to be the go-to. I like Wall. The reason that we've gone with the Wall Sterling is they include, I'm not gonna open this up because you got your own, you can open it. You can see here that they include guards. Now, all clippers include guards for the most, I shouldn't say all, but almost all clippers include guards. What I like about these is these guys have gone crazy with the guards that they've included, and they've included half numbers of guards too, like 0.5s. Instead of most guards go 4-3-2-1, one being the smallest, these guys go down to 0.5, so your skin fades can be that much more seamless. The guards fit on beautifully, they're very snug, and these are fantastic clippers, a really, really great clipper, as good as anything you will ever use out there. Certainly there are more expensive clippers. These aren't cheap though. These are good quality clippers, and if you keep them in great condition, you clean them, you lubricate them, they will last you a lifetime. Little things that you have to do, obviously I just said lubricate them and clean them. They come with a little brush. Really important that you clean them every time you use them, because when they get gummed up with those little micro hairs, they need to get cleaned out. And you can, most people who have clippers, they do a complete tear down every month probably, or real barbers probably do it every week, where they unscrew everything, remove everything, bathe the whole thing in oil, get rid of any shrapnel of hair, and start totally fresh. That's the most important thing you can do with your clippers, is keep them in really, really good working order and never drop them, guys. Things that are corded tend to get dropped, because when you swing your client's chair, her feet will get caught on the cord and then they go flying, and then you have to do her hair and you're kind of freaking out going, my clippers are shot. And it's a hard thing. So when you're done with something, unplug it, wrap it up and put it away so that there's no harm to come to it, okay? But when you're wrapping things up, remember, don't wrap your cord around really tight, because I'll see if I can show it to you on a flat iron later. We gotta make sure that our cords don't get wrecked. Most of the time that things happen with electrical equipment is it's the cords. There becomes an electrical disconnect with cords. Wall sterling, it's a really, really fantastic clipper. Now, here we've gone kind of cheap. And this is one of two things that we sort of cheaped out on a little bit with your kit, guys. These are wall peanuts. Now, I like these. I like the wall peanut. It's been around forever. It's a little, some people consider it tacky. Here's what I like about it. First of all, edgers, little things like this, if they're not corded, that means you have to carry a charger around. And when the battery goes, that thing is, it's ruined. Remember, they don't want you to have your edgers forever, because if you do, then you never have to buy another pair. So you don't want to be carrying around a charger, and then you go to grab your edgers and they're not charged, and then they die in mid-use. It's embarrassing. So I like things that are corded, because they're reliable. Edgers constantly fall, get knocked off places, and they get beat up. And that's going to happen with your $150 edgers or your $50 or $60 edgers like these wall peanuts. Here's what I like about these things. These get as close to the skin as any edgers out there, maybe even closer. I can't believe the quality of these things. They make a horrible sound in your client's ear. They're very loud. They're like, argh. Other clippers have, or edgers have a really nice soft zzz. These things are really loud. They're really awful, but they do the job. They're really powerful. They also come with some guards. If you treat these well, you will probably, you know, every year or so, you'll have to buy a new one, but that's the same with all edgers anyway. So if you treat these well, maybe you get 3 years out of them. I don't know. You can actually buy replacement heads for these as well. And really, that's the only thing that goes wrong with them. It's a tacky tool, but honestly, guys, we use these in all of our salons because they're cheap and they're fantastic. So I like a wall peanut. So there's a couple times I use common sense and I give you guys inexpensive stuff that's really, really good value. And these things are great. And finally, guys, we have your mannequin stand. Now, what we have done, we used to provide these big, crazy, amazing mannequin stands to our students. We just kept a bunch of them in our school, but guess what happened? You guys used to break them and throw the pieces away, that when they hit the floor, you'd chuck them out instead of put them back. And I got really tired of it because they're really expensive, and I bought a lot of these things. And they were all getting broken. So I thought, you know what? I'm gonna give you your own mannequin stand, and then you will take really good care of it, because I know you will, because you're the one who paid for it. So basically, it's all designed with screws and bolts. That's the whole vibe. So we unscrew this, and that allows the legs to open up. And when the legs open up, that kind of lowers this part of it. And then we would tighten that up here, right? So we'll talk a little bit more about the base of it in just a minute. But that holds this really firm now with a nice wide base. The next thing we do when we want to raise and lower this, this is like a quick release on a bicycle tire. So we flip it open, and then all of a sudden, you'll see that? It's spring loaded. So all of a sudden we can raise it to the height that we want, and then close it. And it's really easy. The old ones, you have to twist this thing. These things are great. So if this, watch, if we turn that a few times like this, and then we do that, look at that. It's not tight anymore. Basically, because all it is a screw. So we open it up and we turn it lefty loosey, righty tighty. And now it's tight and it will not go anywhere. But understand this, guys, just like anything else, a screw goes into a bolt. I don't know if you can see this, but there is a hexagonal bolt in here. Now, if you unscrew this too much, that bolt's gonna hit the ground and it doesn't matter. This thing will just pull right out. It has nothing to grip to. So when you hear something hit the ground and you're using your mannequin stand, and this is why I no longer supply them anymore. When you hear a piece of metal hit the ground and you're a hairdresser and something goes clunk, look around for it because it's part of your mannequin stand, guys. Don't throw it away. Don't let somebody sweep it up. So that air, that if you just make sure it's at a proper tightness, you'll never really have to tighten or loosen this. Maybe with time it might loosen up on its own. I don't know. But just definitely, if you notice that all of a sudden it's super loose, look for the bolt. Now, worst case scenario, you can go to Home Depot and get a replacement bolt for this, but don't lose it in the first place and you'll be fine. So let's get that up. And now this should be in camera angle. So here's the next part of our of the mannequin tripod. This portion here, when we loosen that, that spins the top. It also allows the head to rotate on this pivot, right? It's a ball socket joint. So it does two things. It loosens it off here. That should be a little tighter. Anyways, so now once that's tight, you'll notice it doesn't rotate and this stays stiff. So when you're working on your haircuts, sometimes you're gonna wanna tilt the head down. Please, before you just push down on it and force it, just open this up a little bit and then you don't have to push quite so hard and it's less wear and tear on these things. The reason these things break is because people really beat the crap out of them. Don't beat the crap out of your stuff, guys. So once you got it in the position that you want, tighten it up and then it's gonna be pretty firm. And when you wanna change it again, just loosen it and move it. It's really, really simple. It's a really easy thing. These things will last you forever if you treat them well. And there's one final thing. I'm gonna tilt this down so maybe we can see this in the camera. But basically, this, I need a mannequin head. Basically, the mannequin head has a hole in the base like this, and you just pop it down here, give her a bop on the head, and that'll push it down, but she can still come flying off. So I'm gonna show you the coolest part of a mannequin tripod. Once you've bopped her on the head and she's really seated well on this thing, then we turn this guy here. And what this does, I don't know if you can see what's happening. Can you see that? It's opening up. So this is inside of her head, and we pop the mannequin head, and then we turn the thing and it opens up like this, and it keeps her on there super, super tight, and you'll never be able to get her off unless you loosen this off again, right? Now it's all of a sudden it's closed down and you can get her off much easier. Okay, we have kind of a celebrity mannequin here. This is the mannequin from your balayage video by my friend Iris Smith, Glam Iris. So now, we've bopped her on there. She's not going anywhere. Now we've like tightened this guy and now she's like, we could drag her around. She's never going anywhere. Even when we loosen this, which kind of hurts the hands a little bit, and now it's closed inside of her, it's still really hard to get off. The best way to do that, guys, is just put your fingers, you kind of grab her around below her neck and just kind of squeeze and that'll pop her up. Okay, did you see that? So she's on there, she's not going anywhere. Just grab below here and just squeeze and that'll pop her up and then you can get her off. But you'll never be able to do that when this is open. That's Mannequin Stand 101.